Kilnave Gleva. How's your Scots Gaelic tonight? Anybody? Kilnave, the music of heaven. Music of heaven. Gleva, fantastic. So thank you, brother, for bringing us the music of heaven tonight. I said to folks beforehand when Brian was warming up, finally some real Christian music in this place. So that is just fantastic. So thank you. We are delighted to welcome Brian and Cheryl Roby tonight, missionaries with MTW headed to Scotland. Thank you for being with us tonight. We are looking forward to hearing our brother open the scriptures for us and for them to share with us their burden and calling to serve in Scotland. So the folks here regularly get Scottish church history sermon illustrations. That's kind of a regular feature around here. And so I'm pretty pumped. We'll put it that way. Pretty pumped. So thank you for being here tonight. Welcome to all of you. We're just so thankful that you can be here for our evening service. You have the announcements in the bulletin. I'm not going to go through those in detail as I did this morning, only to remind you, next Sunday evening, after our evening service, we'll be gathering back in here, a time of fellowship outside, and then back in here for the Japan prayer meeting, going through five cities and 50 plus years of the Lord's work through MTW in Japan. I was sharing with Brian this morning, I said, if you go into my study here, there's big tartan cushion in my chair and a map of Japan on the wall. And that that pretty much sums up my heart for the foreign field. And that we're just thankful we can be a part of that, a part of this tonight and next week as we lift up the Lord's work that he's doing around the world. I would like to, in light of that, ask you, after the end of the service tonight, after the benediction, could I ask you to indulge me, please, to be seated for about a five-minute meeting. I just need to give you some information. It has to do with some of our missionaries who serve in a secured area, and so we need to go offline for that. So if you would just be patient after the benediction and have a seat, we'll bring you up to date on some very important news. I ask you please to stand for our call to worship this evening. It's a responsive reading, the Word of God from Psalm 145. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever.
Every day I will bless you, and praise your name forever and ever.
Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable.
One generation shall commend your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts.
Amen. Let's take our hymn books, please. We are going to sing the 100th psalm. You will find it as number one in the Trinity hymnal, Psalm 100, All People That on Earth Do Dwell.
Without our aid, he did.
together. Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, on the close of your day, we come into your presence again to bring glory and honor to your name. We come in Jesus' name, the name that is above every name, the name that prevails in heaven and earth, and ask that through Christ our Lord and through his great high priestly work, you will accept our worship this evening. We pray, O Lord, that our praise, our thanksgiving, our prayers will be offered to you through his precious blood, through the acceptance that he has earned, through the grace that he has shown. And we pray that the ministry of the Holy Spirit will come and gather our hearts and unite them as one, with one voice, with one heart. We may extol the greatness of our God. We thank you tonight, O Lord, for this dear couple being with us. And we pray as we hear about the work that you have called them to do in Scotland, that you will expand our vision and you will deepen our burden for the field, for at home, and for wherever you call us to serve. Lord, we pray that tonight, through all that we say and do, great glory and praise and honor will go to your name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Would you please be seated? And we're going to read God's word together from Psalm 78. Psalm 78, please. And we'll read the first four verses. This is God's living and inerrant truth. A Maskil of Asaph. Give ear, O my people, to my teaching. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings from of old, things that we have heard and known, that our fathers have told us. We will not hide them from their children, but tell to the coming generation the glorious deeds of the Lord and his might and the wonders that he has done. Amen. We're going to sing again. This time the hymn is 324, Christ is coming. And I'll ask you to stand again, please.
Oh, priest, for and faith increase.
seated. And now we're going to read from God's Word in the New Testament, 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3. And we will read verses 9 through 13. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn? But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. This is God's living word. The grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of our God stands forever. Well, it is, Brian, so good to have you and Cheryl with us tonight. I'll invite you now to come and bring God's word to us.
Well, it took 30 years, but we finally made it to Hudson, Ohio, Cheryl and I. When we got out of the Army in 1990, I had two job offers. One was work with the engineer office in here in the city of Hudson, and the other was in Chambersburg, Pennsylvania. So whether I chose the right one or not is irrelevant. It's an academic question. The Lord has taken us a long and varied winding journey, and here we are. So thank you so much, Pastor Dodson, Scott Crable, and of course our dear friends Mike and Sue Scott, just for inviting us and giving us the chance to be here. Let's first open with prayer. Gracious God, we are reminded that your word is truth, that your word is a light unto our feet, lamp into our feet, and light into our paths. Lord, help us as your people to not run up ahead of that little circle of light that a lamp projects, but to stay step by step in the will of our dear Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the light of the world. We thank you, Lord, and pray that you would be with us this evening. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So you know the feeling. And by the way, I'm going to be reading from the book of the prophet Zephaniah. It's one of those books when you're going through the ordination exam and they ask you to outline a minor prophet in the New Testament. You either pick something like Zephaniah or Obadiah, you know, one or two or three chapters. Zephaniah chapter 2. Zephaniah was writing, we're told in the very first verse, that he's writing during the reign of Josiah, who was, of course, the last righteous king of Israel. And that does come into play in this prophecy. But before I read the word, I just want to, you know the feeling, right? If you're anything like me, and we do a lot of traveling, a lot of trips, you get on the highway and you're cruising along. You're in the groove, not really paying any attention to the speed limit, sort of keeping up with traffic, maybe staying a little bit ahead of traffic. And it's, you know, the car's feeling good, the road sounds good, and all of a sudden you look in your rearview mirror and there are Christmas lights, right? And you take your foot off the gas and you look down, oops, I wasn't keeping the speed limit. You get in the slow lane. And then the state trooper just, whoosh, he blasts right past you. And you think, oh, good, it wasn't for me. It was someone else. Well, I think as we read this passage, that would be an easy conclusion for the Israelites. So let's read from Zephaniah, reading chapter 2, the first three verses. And this is a thundering declaration from the prophet. He says, gather together, yes, gather, O shameless nation, before the decree takes effect, before the day passes away like chaff, before there comes upon you the burning anger of the Lord. Before there comes upon you the burning anger of the Lord. Seek the Lord, all you humble of the land, who do his just commands. Seek righteousness. Seek humility. Perhaps you may be hidden on the day of the anger of the Lord. A thundering declaration. But then he goes on and he begins to name the people to whom he's addressing this prophecy. And it's you know, he starts out with the quad cities of the Philistines. You know, he names the cities Ashdod, Ashkelon, Ekron, Gaza, and then he goes to the Moabites and the Ammonites. Those are they're close cousins to the Israelites, but they were enemies when Moses and the people of Israel were on their way to the Promised Land. The Moabites and the Ammonites opposed them. These are tribes from way back in Genesis, if you recall the incestuous, the kind of the seedy story that even on daytime television would cause Jerry Springer to blush. Lot, through an incestuous relationship with his daughters, fathers these two tribes. All right, these are the people, and God's pronouncing judgment on them. He's pronouncing judgment on the Assyrians. The Assyrians were the wicked people of the time, and they were kind of at the time of this prophecy, they were still the big dogs on the block. About a century before, they had gone through and they had conquered and crushed the northern kingdom, Samaria, taken them captive. And you can still, the Assyrians, like most tyrants, they were very proud of what they had done, and they recorded their deeds. And you can still today go to the British Museum in London, and you can see there have been about 80 feet of mural that was recovered from the ancient site of Nineveh. And it's these stone carvings of the armies of Assyria besieging cities and torturing the captive, taking captives, and just the horrible, burning, flaming brands being thrown down, and just the horror of the things that they did. God's going to judge these people. And so it would be easy if you were an Israelite to say, whew, that's not for us. But the timing of this, during the reign of Josiah, yes, Josiah was a righteous king, and Josiah cleaned house. Josiah was responsible for arguably the most thorough Reformation revival in the Judah's history. He even, as they say, got rid of the high places. He's about the only king that's said about. He was thorough. But as you read deeper, what you find is it was a top-down revival. God changed the heart of Josiah, but he didn't affect the heart of the people. And it never made it beyond that top level. So when Josiah was taken out, the people went right back to idolatry, and they went back in spades. They went back to their old ways. And the people to whom this prophecy is addressed, many of them would see not one, not two, but three exiles of the Babylonians. The next, barely a blip on the radar at the time of this prophecy, but that was the next wave that was coming. Was the Chaldeans from Babylon, and that third exile would be preceded by 18 months of the most horrible a siege that the conditions, scripture uses it as kind of a type of God's pouring out his judgment. And just in the book, you can read about it in the book of Lamentations. Horrible details. Women cooking, boiling the bodies of their dead children just in order to eat to survive. People collecting bird droppings and selling them or making them. I don't know what you make out of a bird droppings, but eating that anything just to stay alive. Those kinds of things were coming on the people of Israel, but they didn't have a clue. And I would say, similarly, it would be easy for us to look at the situation in the UK and in Scotland and to say, oh, good, it's not us. And I'm gonna show you some statistics that kind of chilled me when I first saw them. But if anything, if we learned anything in the 60s, and those of us who were around, we learned anything, is that the culture comes from east to west, right? The Beatles, the they call it the British Invasion. It was the Beatles and the Who, and it was Led Zeppelin. All the music came. Bell bottoms, super skinny supermodels. All of those things, many of which they'd have kept them, but those things came from England from the UK to America. Very few things ever go the other way from us to them. I can testify to you that preventative dentistry still has not made its way to the UK. So what's coming our way, and how bad is it? When you say Chick-fil-A, my grandson's ears perk up like a German Shepherd. I mean, Chick-fil-A. And we all know what a great Chick-fil-A has sort of become the darling of the evangelicals, right? And it's only been 10 years, believe it or not, since they went from being kind of a regional, the cute billboards with the cows in Georgia and Tennessee, to really a national phenomenon. And it was because the CEO, Dan Cathy, made it in the midst of some of the arguing in the national debate concerning same-sex attraction, gay marriage, and so forth. He made this fiery statement. He made a radical inflammatory statement about gay marriage. And here's the actual quote. It was on a radio talk show, kind of obscure talk show. He said, "I think we are inviting God's judgment on our nation when we shake our fist at him and say, we know better than you as to what constitutes a marriage. I pray God's mercy on our generation." Tell him that. That's what he said. And that rather heartfelt statement incurred the wrath of the gay lobby, and they blasted Chick-fil-A with everything they had. I think they may have overplayed their hand at the time by the mercy of God and the lobbying of Mike Huckabee. Just common people ended up supporting Chick-fil-A, and their sales actually went up by almost 13% over that, and it stayed there over the coming months. And you know, when God promises to pour out blessing, when you read about it, you read, you know, God, I'll pour out, it'll be overflowing, packed down, shaken together. And there's a flip side to that, and that is that you got to handle all that, right? And suddenly they had tons and tons of customers coming in, and they rose to the occasion by basically delivering what is today the gold standard of customer service. In 2021, for the seventh year in a row, Chick-fil-A, there's something called the ACSI is the acronym, something Customer Service Index, Association American, I don't know. But if the ACSI Index for the seventh year in a row ranked Chick-fil-A as the number one in the fast food sector in customer service and customer satisfaction, right? They rose to the occasion. That was America. Now in the UK, about a year before COVID, Chick-fil-A went to open up their first restaurant out in Reading, the other Reading, England. And it took 8 days for the lobby to shut them down. There was simply no tolerance for the kind of view. And that, there was the clout to shut them down. So it's a different ball game over in the UK. There's a well-known Scottish pastor, some of you might be familiar with, David Robertson. He's done a blog for years and years called The Wee Flea. And I heard him say just a couple months ago that, in his opinion, Scotland was the most secular country in Europe, which is saying quite a bit. That's some real competition that they've got there. I want to walk you through put some hard numbers to this, these anecdotes. So let's first start, what do a health clinic, let me see, can everybody see?
I think we're gonna get the lights in a little bit too.
Yeah.
Okay.
There we go.
So a health clinic, a community center, and an Indian restaurant have in common. Well, they are all repurposed churches. They have been, in the last few decades, churches have been shut down and turned into something else. Those are all within about a 5.5 mile radius of each other, very close to the town where we're going. The Indian restaurant the pastor was telling us, he said, we go there all the time, and he said, and now to be fair, it's great curry, but so at least they've got that. But this land, the land that gave us George Wishart and John Knox, Eric Little, I think John Patton, the minister to the Hebrides, the cannibals in the New Hebrides, gave us that. Revivals, even up into as recently as 1921, revivals for thousands and thousands of people coming to Christ. This is their situation right now. And so it was, and that was the message that I heard in 2017 from David Meredith, a gentleman who was the missions director for the Free Church of Scotland. And these are some of the statistics that he shared. The view, this was a survey done by the Barna Group, so it's a well done, well carried out, good, accurate, good statistics, good data. Almost 90%, what's your view of the Bible? And 86%, so 17 out of 20, negative or indifferent. I like this statistic. When you put those two together, how often do you read your Bible? Essentially, 9 out of 10 people almost never. Have you read your Bible in the last year? This little 10% here on the left is the only more than four times a year. The rest of the people, and we tend to over-report on ourselves. So I suspect that most of that 90% probably didn't crack that. They thought about opening their Bible and gave themselves credit for it. I think though that's a rich. I'm excited about that because Jesus is captivating. And if you can get people to look at the Bible and walk through it with them, my experience is they are fascinated by the person of Jesus. We've been working, St. Louis is a town with a significant, like, some estimates are as high as 100 to 110,000 Muslims in St. Louis. Been working with Muslims for 5 or 6 years now. And a friend and I are just walking two brothers through the Gospel of Luke. And these are guys who were always trying to convert us, but as they have seen the person and work of Jesus, they're captivated. They're captivated by the fact that there's a story, that there's that the whole thing holds together, that there's a conclusion, beginning, end, and conclusion. That just, he's irresistible to people if you can just get them into the scriptures. So that's kind of exciting. Here's really, about half of Scottish people would self-identify as Christians. But when you really dig deep into what they believe, about 3 to 5%, what you and I would consider a Bible-believing Christian. And when you, the study actually broke down the demographics in the 18 to 45-year-old demographic. So there you're talking about the people who are having families and starting small businesses and beginning to get on the school boards and the kind of the people that are really starting to get their feet under them and make the community work. In that demographic, less than 2% fall into this category of Bible-believing Christians, which, according to the Joshua Project, makes that an unreached people group. So this is the situation. Actually, Cheryl's got a story. You have to project a little bit.
Okay.
But.
There are some missionaries that are already there in Scotland, and they were ministering to the area of St. Andrews, and the wife decided that she wanted to do a Bible club after school. And so had been talking to her at one of our missions conferences, and she said, anyway, so she, I had said, well, how did you manage to get into the schools? Because they're, you know, worse than we are as far as, you know, keeping religion out. And she said, really, it was quite easy because the Scottish government feels like, well, it's just the Bible is just a bunch of fairy tales and no one's going to believe it anyway. So go ahead and have your little Bible club. It's okay. So she did. She started a Bible club and then got to the point where, you know, the time of year when it was Christmas time, and she proceeded to tell the children the Christmas story and the fact that the baby's name was going to be called Jesus. And the next day, a little boy went up to his teacher and he just, you know, put his hand on his hip and he said, you know, teacher, I don't get it. And she said, what don't you get? And he said, I don't get why anybody would name a baby a swear word. And so that, in a nutshell, is why we feel like we need to get there yesterday. Because they don't know that Jesus is a real person. They don't know that he is their savior. And so, yeah, we feel like we have brothers and sisters that are over there, but they just don't know it yet. So.
Yep. And we read Psalm 78. It's kind of our theme verse. Verse 4 is, we'll tell the next generation the glorious works of God's. So that kind of gives you, it doesn't take long to lose the gospel. And one of the last things, when David Meredith showed all of these statistics, he said, but here's the thing. He said, there are young men in Scotland on fire for the Lord. They are smart, they are well trained, and they love Jesus. And he said they just need older believers to come alongside them. And I thought, I fit in that. Well, Cheryl and I both thought we fit that demographic. So God has raised these people up, and in a little innocuous village in northern Scotland, Burghead, there's a unassuming church with a very humble pulpit. God raised up a young man by the name of Peter Turnbull. And he was an Anglican minister. And the Anglican church, the Church of England, is kind of a mixed bag. There are faithful congregations, and there are others that have sort of gone off the cliff. He was an assistant pastor in a faithful congregation, gospel preaching. And the Lord just led him to come up to this part of Scotland. He took a church with a few dozen souls, and pre-COVID they had a regular attendance of 70 or more. They're continuing to grow. 70, by the way, is a pretty good sized church in Scotland. Here's his family. We got to spend a little over a week with them. Five children, which that's a good sized family wherever you are, but in the UK that's a huge family. And we love them. We fell in love with them and the kids. They reached out to their community. Of course, you know, scones, biscuits, food is love. One of our pastors always said. They're strategically placed there right across the street from the school. And of course, when you've got five kids, the school does get to know you. And as Cheryl said, it's that same attitude of, what's it going to hurt to send our kids? And so the kids go. They have a Bible club after school. They give them in a winsome, engaging way the scriptures. This was a Christmas program. This is their Easter program. How they incorporated Paw Patrol into the Easter story, I'm not sure. But you see, there's the cross on the left. There's the empty tomb on the right, and Jesus is alive. They've got the elements there, and they put it in a way that the kids would be attracted to it. Peter keeps their attention, and more. What he's done is I think this is probably one of the bigger hurdles that he had, was getting the congregation involved. There's this idea that outreach, evangelism, sharing the faith, that's for the paid professionals, and the rest of us, you know, we warm a pew on Sunday and then go about our business. And to change that mindset, to say we are disciples of Christ, we are followers of Jesus, and we are ambassadors wherever we go. So we are a kingdom of priests, whether it's in the classroom, in the home, in your small business, on the factory line, wherever God finds us and puts us, we take the message of the gospel there with us. And I think that's the biggest change that he was able to accomplish. Now, Berghead is the largest cities of Scotland, going from largest down there on the kind of the lower left, Glasgow, the little bit east is Edinburgh, go up the coastline, you have Aberdeen and Dundee, Inverness is you kind of see it in that crook there. Those are your top five cities. Berghead is a tiny little village. It's up on the North Sea. Roughly the same latitude as Juneau, Alaska, which is wonderful in the summertime. Sun doesn't set till 10:30, 11 o'clock. And it's a little dicey in the winter. We were, you know, on the phones now, you've got those apps. So we were checking all winter long. And sunrise was on December 21st, the sun rose at 9 o'clock and it set at 3:30. So this time, the days are lengthening now. We're all getting normal. But what makes this little out of the way place? Well, first of all, it's absolutely beautiful. And the people that are there, there's a very kind of a positive attitude. You're right on the sea. It was built, even though the site has been occupied since the Bronze Age, but the town itself was built in the early 1800s for the fishing, for the herring trade. And all these native sandstone, these beautiful stone cottages, all laid out in a pattern. It's a well-planned town, and they're just as solid as they can be. There is a harbor there, which was again for the herring trade. The modern herring boats are too big for this harbor. So what you see here are lobster. The commercial fishing that goes on now is the lobster fishing. We still haven't tried any lobster. We're waiting. If Lord willing, we go back. We want to definitely get some native lobster. It's on the site of an ancient Pictish fort. The Picts, P-I-C-T-S, were basically the people that kept the Romans out of Scotland. You remember the Braveheart, the blue face thing. William Wallace is roughly 1100, so he's a little bit after the Picts. But the idea of painting yourself with a blue chalk that probably had some kind of a hallucinogenic or drug in it, so that, you know, to help the warrior be more fearless in battle. That's your Picts. Think of those people. This was one of the five largest sites in the world, Pictish forts. It was apparently an incredibly significant spot from about the 3rd to the 8th century. When you look the other direction, and I'm standing in roughly the same place that I took that last picture, and the harbor, the tides are really dramatic, about 15, 20 foot between high tide and low tide. And so this is at low tide. I was talking to the postmaster, and he said, you know, in the 40s, in the early 1940s, you won't find a picture of Burghead in any magazine or newspaper, because they used these beaches to rehearse the Normandy invasion. So again, it's one of these little out of the way places that keeps popping up, keeps being significant. And this is what really caught Cheryl and I as was talking to the pastor, and we've been communicating for several months. And we had already made the decision that we want to go visit. And he just mentioned in passing that there is a large air base, RAF base, in one direction, and a combat engineer barracks in the other direction. So Lossiemouth Air Base is up there on the upper right, and Kinloss Barracks in the lower left. Cheryl and I have always wanted to have some sort of an outreach to the military. When we were in the Army, we would always have Bible studies in the barracks with the soldiers, and what you find is that people whose job it is whose job has the possibility of facing a life or death situation tend to be interested in the eternal. And it's not a hard thing to get them, again, to open the Bible. And there's some, God's the Lord of hosts, right? Host is that old English word for an army on parade. Our God is a God who cares about, you looked in the New Testament, almost nothing is ever, whenever there's a soldier, a centurion, it's always a pod. There's very few. I mean, the soldiers in the Praetorium, Praetorian Guard that abused Jesus, one of the few examples of a negative portrayal of a military person. So, the Bible is very fond of the military, and it's just a good fit. And so, when Peter told us that, and this, by the way, Burghead is there in the center. 6 miles one direction, 6 miles the other direction. That's not a big area that you're looking at there. I don't know your geography around here, but it's 15 minutes one way, 15 minutes the other. So within a very close, and it always has seemed to us, think about it, when we were in the military, we thought, you know, so what's a missionary? A missionary is a person who goes to a place he's never been, meets people he doesn't know, and tells them about Jesus. Which, if you've been in the military, that's pretty much what you do every 3 years, right? You switch off. And so, when you disciple military people, what are you doing? You're training missionaries. You're equipping them with the gospel, and then they're going to go out. And particularly in the British system, they're going to go literally to the four corners of the earth. They're going to go all over the world and take the gospel with them. So we're very excited about that, and I do feel it's a strategic location. So the situation in Burghead, these, again, we're in this about the same scale, 20 minutes in between those three towns. Burghead, Elgin is the county seat, and then Forres is where the barracks, the engineer barracks is at. And there used to be three Free Church of Scotland churches in that picture there. There's now two. There is the Forest and Elgin combined, and there's a church in Elgin. A couple of dozen souls. Cheryl and I, when we visited, there were with us there, there were 21 people. So we increased their attendance by 10% that Sunday. You know, the pastor's good. He good, solid preaching. But they're just, I think, they're tired. And so the plan is to continue to grow Berghead, to take a team, and the Peter, the gentleman you saw, is assembling a team to, excuse me just a second. Yeah, so he's assembling a team, and they're going to revitalize the church after the pastor in Elgin retires. They'll be revitalizing that church there, and then basically instilling a disciple-making ethos into that church, such that they will then revitalize that church with the idea of replanting a church in Forres. I want to take a second then to, there's the video I'd like to show you from Peter, and let him speak.
My name's Peter. I'm the minister at Berghead Free Church. We're a congregation of the Free Church of Scotland in the little fishing village of Berghead. We're in the rural northeast of Scotland. When many folks think of Scotland, they think of our amazing Christian history. They think of churches flourishing, centered on the scriptures, and they think of mission work. That is, missionaries being sent out from Scotland to many nations around the world. But very sadly, that Scotland has long since ceased to exist. Churches here in Scotland have declined rapidly. The nation is now extremely secular. Perhaps just 2 or 3% of the population would be evangelical, Bible-believing Christians. There are some mission organizations who classify nations around the world as being unreached. And I think by those measures, Scotland is not too far off being considered an unreached country. Most of the churches here are small, weak, financially only just viable, or not viable at all in many cases. Other congregations, and indeed whole denominations, have drifted from the gospel and from the authority of scripture. And so we here in Scotland now, and that includes us here in Berghead in the county of Murray, we're in need of missionary workers to come and serve the Lord Jesus and his church here, and to share the gospel in a nation that doesn't know him anymore. And for us here in Berghead, our church has been undergoing a process of revitalization, and by God's grace, our congregation has grown in the last 6 years in my time here. New folks have been reached with the gospel, and the church has been strengthened. But we look across Murray, that's the region that we're in, and there is a great need for other churches to be revitalized and for new churches to be planted. And we here in Berghead are going to be involved in that work. But all of this against a backdrop where gospel workers are few and resources are scarce. So the thought for us that Brian and Cheryl would consider moving from St. Louis, Missouri, from a thriving congregation, to come here to Birkhead to be with us, to work with us in Murray, in church revitalization and in church planting, is extraordinary. It's amazing to us to think that someone would come from the States to this small corner of Scotland to be involved in the mission of Jesus here. And I can tell you there is a great, great need, and that we would love it if you were willing to partner with them and by extension with us in the work of the gospel and in proclaiming the name of the Lord Jesus Christ in Birkhead, in Murray and in Scotland, a nation that on the whole no longer knows him.
So our goal is to be in Scotland to celebrate Easter 2023 in Scotland. We are, of course, raising our funding right now. This is our monthly needs, our monthly budget. We would be honored if you would partner with us. I've got some partnering levels. Except for a little as $50 a month, you can be a Klansman. in all seriousness, we will be after the service in the back. We'd love to probably take questions after that.
Yeah, sure. You can take questions.
Take questions
sure.
Now. Yeah. Okay. Let me. Are there any questions? I kind of meant to say this is take questions as we go.
Is there any general idea that what has caused Scotland to be so secular, considering its roots?
I'm researching that right now. I'm reading a book with a fascinating title of Mission Work in Contemporary Scotland, written by a Scottish pastor. He doesn't give a reason. It apparently, though, happened in the 50s, was kind of the zenith of church attendance in Scotland. I think, honestly, though, kind of reading between the lines, that similar things that were happening here with the mainline churches that had already been kind of in the works, you know, the Presbyterian Church, of course, and the Princeton, the folks in the late 1800s, and then Machen was fighting that battle in the early parts of the 20th century. The fundamentals statement in the, 1903, and then the Auburn Confession of 1923. Those battles had been fought, were being fought hard here, and they were beginning to be lost. But there were still, our denomination comes out of the South, and there were still churches in the South holding fast to the gospel. And then even some up here, obviously the RPCES came out of Pennsylvania and New Jersey. But I think in Scotland, I'm inferring this, that when that liberalism came in, this Scottish people tend to be a little intolerant of anything that, you know, they don't suffer fools lightly. And they just said, I'm not going to church. Why should I go to church if they're not even going to, if they don't believe what they're teaching, why should I waste my time with it? I think they just reacted more strongly. There was a sense here in America where you did have people, as my father-in-law said, you got to kick out the dents from the inside of the can. You know, you had Bible-believing people staying in a church that was rapidly declining, doing their best by God's grace to turn it around. I don't think you had that in Scotland. And so when the decline hit, there was nothing to stop the slide. Yeah. Good question.
What holds this country together as a country? In terms of their culture, their beliefs, when you usually get this kind of individualism, it tends to fragment.
That's a great question. And as an outsider, I really don't have an authoritative answer for it. You're right that you tend to see fragmentation. There is a Scottish National Party in the right around 2000. The British government devolved, so Wales, Northern Ireland, and Scotland got their own parliaments. They kind of devolved power out. There's still a central government in London, in the main parliament, but each of those regions also has its own parliament. So the Scottish National Party kind of came in, and they're still sort of the majority, and it's a very, hey, nationalistic, we want our independence, we're distinctly Scottish. They're united by their distaste of the English, right? Nobody likes the English. So yeah, they're united by what they're against. I think that's the answer to your question. They haven't really pushed. Now they're upset at Brexit up in Scotland because things like these fishing boats, right? Brexit hurt them because the EU, they're just being mean, and if a Scottish boat catches fish, they can't sell it to Finland or Holland. They can't sell to their markets anymore. Same fish from the same schools, from the same waters, but because you're not part of the EU, you can't sell. So yeah, that's just, you know, Europeans being Europeans. But I don't know what God's going to do with that. I think he could leverage something like that. The thing with Scotland being an independent nation is I kind of doubt. There's a lot of talk about it, but then somebody says, well, how are we going to collect the garbage? And suddenly the reality of, you know, making the trains run and the water, toilets flush becomes a little overwhelming. So good question though.
Brian, would you talk a little bit about your personal journey? You mentioned that you got out of the military in 90. And so I'm curious about kind of what your journey has been. And obviously, there's a huge need in Scotland. But what's the leap from 1990 to Scotland in 2023? Can you kind of fill in some of that history for me?
Yeah. So most of the time I've spent in corporate America, either in sales or in management. In 2015, I went to seminary, I graduated from Covenant in 2002. The circumstances of our family situation and what I ran into chose not to take a call at that time. I got licensed in the Missouri Presbytery, but had a good job. I've always found that my experience, and I don't want to discourage anybody, but in seminary, it seemed to me that God takes a very few people and gifts them from the get-go to be pastors. And you can see them when you see them, you know it. But for a lot of the guys that come out of college and go straight into seminary, I just kind of wonder, have you really... do you know life yet? And so it's always seemed to me that there is no place that's not a mission field. I mean, obviously when you're a manager, you gotta be careful. You can't, it's just common sense that I can't take one of my subordinates and say, now listen, you're a sinner in the sight of God, you need to repent. And, you know, well, is this gonna affect my pay raise? You know? But I always enjoyed sharing with my boss, sharing with my peers, other managers, and so I guess I never lost that desire for, which as I think back on it, it's kind of mission work here. But it always seemed to me that I didn't need that. And I remember in seminary, I even came to seminary, I was in my 40s, and there was a cluster of us. They were in our 40s, and I remember the young guys that were just out of college, you know, most of us had, we were either elders or deacons, we'd served in churches, we taught the confession, and so, you know, we raised our hand because we knew the questions, we knew what questions we had and the questions that were being asked in the churches, and so those are the things that we wanted answers to. And I remember the other students would, it was kind of embarrassing because they come, you guys ask such good questions. It's because we spent 20 years not having them answered. So that was kind of, I guess, my own personal journey as I've sort of resisted the call to vocational ministry. But I've been on staff at Twin Oaks since 2015. I'm the administrative director, which I tell people, I'm the pastor's left offensive tackle. I make sure he doesn't get blindsided, and try to do whatever I can to help the ministry so that whoever's filling the pulpit can be freed to do that. Which I'm going to put a plug in for your pastor here. You all have a job to do that for him, to clear the way so that he can spend his time in prayer and the word. Because that's how this church is going to grow. That's how every church grows, right? Is the elders doing what the elders are called to do, the deacons doing what the deacons are called to do, folks in the pew doing what the folks in the pew are called to do, which is to talk about Jesus anywhere, anytime.
And then just tell about 2017 when you went to the conference.
Well, yeah, and I mentioned that meeting and hearing, kind of a Nehemiah moment for me, was hearing the director of the Missions for the Free Church talk about these statistics, and it shocked me. It was like hearing that the gates of Jerusalem are burned and the walls are broken down. This is Scotland. Come on, surely it can't be that bad, and it is. So that's my personal journey. Yes, ma'am.
Do you yet have specific plans about what you think you'll do when you get there?
So do I have specific plans about what I think I'll do? It'll be my specific plan is to do whatever they need me to do. Right now, the session of the church is kind of working out. They've got sort of a plan A and a plan B, and we'll probably work up a plan C. But continue to grow the congregation there in Birkhead, and then, you know, does Peter, whom you met, does he take a team? And they will keep that congregation in Elgin, that small, struggling congregation. But what they're gonna do is they're going to merge, they're gonna have one session and one budget for those two churches. And they'll have services at both churches. So the decision's gonna have to be, you know, who does Peter, kind of, he's sort of the church planter revitalizer. Does he go there and lead the work in Elgin? And then the intern and I stay in Birkhead and continue to foster and minister? Or does one of us go there? That's still going to have to be decided. So the concept of the operation is combine the two churches, keep services in both, and then one of the pastoral team goes and ministers and grows Elgin, and then from Elgin. But it's filling in the names of those places. That hasn't been done yet. Regardless of which direction that goes, our plan is going to be, we need to find a place where we can invite our neighbors in. One of the, kind of surprised me, but apparently Scottish people don't necessarily, they don't do a lot of inviting you into their house, which is kind of cool because we get a pass on any cultural faux pas because we're just Americans, what do we know? So we can do all these things that nobody does, and they'll just say, well, it's just a bunch of Americans. So our intent is to have everybody that'll say yes over to our house. We have already connected with a military ministry to the servicemen there in those two air bases. So we've connected with them, and we're going to, that's going to be one of the things we're definitely going to be working on. And Peter has okayed that, because that's a significant number of their members do come from those military bases. So that much I can, did that kind of answer your question?
One or two more.
And we will be outside at the table. We've got a sign-up sheet. If you want to get our newsletter, please share your email address with us. We'd love to do that and share with you.
Fantastic.
So,
okay.
Thank you.
All right, Brian, I'm going to ask you to stay up here. Cheryl, I'm going to ask you to come up and join him because I want to pray for you. Both, and then we are going to take a love offering for the Robies tonight. Where is Scott Crable? Would you just stand and give us the details for the love offering?
Yeah. So, checks, if you make a check, the account comes to W. The account number is 400, and I can repeat this after 400-524. And if you have any questions, just see me afterwards. If you didn't bring your check,
and we've got prayer cards with all that information on them on the table.
So we will pray, and then we'll receive the evening offering for them. All of the gifts in this will go to them. So you write the check to MTW 400-524. 400-524. Those are the magic numbers, right? And yeah, I see the levels up here. Now, traditionally, only a clan chief should wear feathers in his bonnet. I hope you know that. Only, but if you will give $800 to $1,200 a month, I will buy you feathers. Okay, I will buy them for you myself. All right, let's pray together. Father in heaven, we come to you tonight. And we give you thanks for this dear couple. We thank you for saving them, for bringing them together as husband and wife, for giving them one heart to serve you wherever you call them. And now, Lord, you are leading them to Berghead. And Father, we pray that they will go in the power of the Spirit, the fullness of the Spirit, that they will soon get the support that they need. Father, we ask you to bring in the funds to use tonight's love offering, and Father, to lead and guide many to have a burden for this work. Lord, we pray tonight for the land of Scotland. We pray for our brothers and sisters in the Free Church of Scotland. We thank you, Lord, for their faithfulness over so many years. We pray that you will revitalize the work there, that you will strengthen it, that you will grow it and expand it. And in this land that has seen so many revivals, please send revival again. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
All right. Oh, I think we get a little more keel nave for the offertory then. Wonderful.
Thank you. excuses, but they're rather finicky with humidity and temperature.
Take your hymn books, turn to 469, and I'll ask you to stand, please, as we sing. 469, how sweet and awesome is the place.
Oh,
Blessing. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever. Amen.